I would love to know what you mean by cultural identity. What does it mean in terms of your research?
I'm trying to look at identity more as a shared idea. We can't just judge someone based on how they look and that sort of stuff, because it's not really valid. So I'm trying to take that concept back into history.
Hello, Cristina, and welcome to PhD Hard Talk. Thank you so much for coming on and wanting to discuss your research, essentially. Could you please introduce your research to the wider audience?
Hi, Noma, and thank you so much for having me. I'm very happy to be here. So in order to talk about my research, I thought I would take this on three levels kind of thing and go more and more into detail. So at the very basic area, I'm looking at the idea of how identities of people change mm-hmm. as they move around, they interact with other cultures, and this is more of a social science-y area, but what I'm doing, I'm taking this idea and applying it into the more archaeological, historical context, mm-hmm. and I'm taking basically this idea almost 2,000 years back, and I'm looking at these communities of soldiers in the Roman Empire between the 1st and 3rd centuries AD, and how they were being moved from province to province. So they started from their hometown, and then they arrived in Britain, and then all the way to Romania. And I'm just trying to see if throughout this whole long journey, they kept any of their identities, or they changed it, how much they changed it. And my tool of doing this is actually pottery. So their ceramics, their vessels, and how they speak about who they were and what they preserved and what they changed about themselves.
Okay, so I've read through bits of your work, and you know, I would love to know what you mean by cultural identity. What does it mean in terms of your research?
That's a very good and big question, and I kind of tackle it a lot in my lead review, because if you think about it, my research talks about identities of people, but is it like cultural? Is it ethnic identity? Is it social identity? Because somehow they all overlap. And the reason that I decided to go for cultural identity is because I'm looking more at their practices, and not necessarily ethnical identity could also be valid, but it's a little bit too narrow. And the reason that I'm kind of staying away from that is because ethnicity used to be quite a big argument back in the 19th century with Charles Darwin and all the race discussion and that sort of stuff. And that's not the point that I'm trying to make. I'm just trying to look at identity more as a shared idea that doesn't necessarily have to do with someone necessarily, you know, being born there, but someone that, I don't know, maybe came from somewhere else and ended up taking those cultures, which is what we see nowadays anyway, you know. We can't just judge someone based on how they look and that sort of stuff, because it's not really valid. So I'm trying to take that concept back into history, if that makes sense, and just encapsulate a lot more people, because mm-hmm. otherwise, if I'm talking strictly about Batavians, how would I actually know? What if there are other neighbors who joined them and they ended up picking up their practices and their culture? So that's the reason I wanted to go for this wider view of cultural identity.
Okay, so also in your research, you've mentioned the word abroad, right? Yeah. If you were going back centuries, mm-hmm. you know, certain parts of the world, there weren't really countries. So I would love to know what the definition of abroad is for your research specifically.
Yes, again, very good question, because it's not like you had exact boundaries and you had to show your passport and prove, okay, this is me, can I now go? So it's more about the idea of going out of your element, and also focusing a lot on the idea of being just around other people on the one hand, we have these Batavians that I'm focusing on, and they are basically people from nowadays Netherlands. Mm-hmm. And they end up in Britain. And in Britain, we're already dealing with other groups of people, which have different ceramics, different practices. So it's them being into that context outside of what they already know. So that's the abroad definition, let's say, just being outside of your usual surroundings and the things that you normally know you're accustomed to.
Okay, so for example, if I was, oh, I don't know, capital cities. Oh, let's say if I was in Paris,
okay,
and I decided to go to the south of France. So does that mean that I'm abroad?
Okay, I like that question. And I'm just gonna go to the example of Britain for this. So Britain, before being encapsulated in the Roman Empire, used to be a conglomeration of tribes, mm-hmm. from the north all the way to the south. Mm-hmm. And interestingly, even if we see it nowadays as a kind of a whole body, as a country, back then the tribes from the south were completely different to the tribes that you'd see in the north, in Scotland, for example. And actually, you know, other research and everything show that, in fact, tribes from the southern part of Britain had cultures and practices and consumptions, everything was closer to the northern part of France. Mm-hmm. So, you know, it was that water kind of setting them apart, but they were more similar than they were to people who were on the same territory as them, but just further north. So somehow, yes, you could be abroad. You would end up not knowing anything, you know, completely far away from your people. So you would think, yes, you're abroad.
Okay. I mean, so essentially, if we move it to current day, current situation, so if somebody will concentrate on England or Britain, if someone is in Wales, well, it's a different country, maybe. We'll say the Midlands. If someone moves from the Midlands, which is far from London, mm-hmm. and they go to London, does that mean that they are in a foreign land?
I'm trying to put the Midlands on the map and trying to imagine the tribes that you know, the groups of people
like
that were
Birmingham,
maybe.
Like, you know, in Birmingham. And go into London, does that
I think it wouldn't be as dramatic, the change. They're still kind of close, but still every single group of people had their own thing. They had their own leaders, so they didn't really interact with one another as in like we're all the same. Not really. They had their own authorities, practices and everything. And then if we look on the map of Iron Age Britain, so you would see that they are different. And when they were invaded, let's say, it was kind of a gradual process, because somehow the Roman armies had to conquer each area part by part. It wasn't like, okay, I got this area, basically everybody's like done and dusted. No, it was a very gradual one that happened over years.
Okay, so in terms of, I understand what you're saying, but I'm thinking of current day in Birmingham, the Roman accent, right? That's quite distinctive. And then you go to London as well, the accent's quite distinctive. And then let's say we'll take Barnsley or Doncaster, the accent's quite different. So in terms of regions, you know exactly whom you're talking to, and you know in your head, okay, that's where you're from, that's where mm-hmm. you're from. And then we've got received pronunciation for a certain group as well, so that no one knows where they're from, you know, that's a taught skill. So I'm trying to look at it in modern day and I guess understand, because we've got, you know, local MPs as well. Does that mean it's still the same format? Because then previously it wasn't really like parliament in that sense, but we've got local MPs that can be seen as a chief.
Yeah, for that
group, and they do run things. They look at the budget for schools, public toilets, and all of that stuff. So in a way, I guess what I was trying to ascertain is that you've looked at it, you know, from current day to see if the same framework would work in current day and in terms of history, or maybe it has changed. Because based on what you're saying, I'm thinking it's still the same concept. It's just that we've changed the terminology to say, okay, you're the local MP, you know, you look after the NHS, you look after this, you make those decisions, and you take it, you know, to the House of Parliament and have a negotiation based on the, you know, the census. You know how many people live there, you know how many children, ethnic background. So, you know, we need 4 churches, maybe mosques and a temple, you know, et cetera, et cetera. You know, that's what I was thinking. And I was you might, you know, have looked at it from that perspective, that's all.
That's a great perspective. I haven't really thought about it that much, simply because it's just nowadays we have these official territories, so I haven't actually looked that much in depth. But I think that's a really good point, because it's the same now. We have, you know, as you said, all these different areas, kind of similar, people having even like their specific traditions. You know, when I went for a placement somewhere at the border with Scotland, they had this kind of special Burns Day about this poet, and they would have like specific food and stuff. And so I'm at Exeter, so that's all the way south. Mm-hmm. And that wasn't a big deal in Exeter, you know, like I haven't really heard officially about it and being celebrated like that. So it was, you know, just people having 2 different sets of values somehow, and what they believe as important and as a big day. So yeah, even nowadays, that's still very much applicable.
Yeah. It's quite interesting anyway. I find it interesting. So in terms of the title then, I read your title. It's cultural identity and the ways it changes when people move, mm-hmm. are moved abroad. So in terms of definitions, right, when you say people move, that's mm-hmm. me having choice. Mm-hmm. Are moved, it sounds as if they're being moved. So how do you, what's the word I'm looking for, define what are moved abroad means and people move? What are the definitions so that it's quite clear to somebody who'd like to read your research?
So it's a mixture of both, I would say. On the one hand, you have the units in the army and you're enrolled and the authority says, okay, it's time to move here. We're having troubles in this part of the empire. Let's move here now. So the unit is being moved there. So it arrives from Netherlands, it arrives in the UK somewhere. Mm-hmm. And that's being moved. It's not like you just say, no, I don't want to move. There's no such thing. You enroll, you're part of this. You have to move. But then what we see, and that's actually really interesting, people from home, families that they left behind, they move. So they follow their husbands, their fathers. And this is actually, I like that it's been shedded a lot of light on this recently. And at Vindolanda, all the way in the north of England, at the border with Scotland, they discovered leather shoes, which are actually kind of like tiny size that could be either for children and that, or they could be for women. They look amazing. So if people are interested, they can look on, you know, on the internet. They are like, you know, the flip flops with the thing in between the the big toe, and so the shoes look like that. That's amazing. So, you know, it's materials like that that kind of shed light. Okay, it's not only about the military, about the men, but actually, you know, other communities also moved with them because they wanted to be with them, and they built, maybe they either lived in the forts with them or they built adjacent communities. You know, they're called Vici, Vicus, singular, which is just this community that develops alongside with these forts. And that's where you'd see the non-military people living, or the veterans maybe who decided to stay in the area where they were garrisoned and they just never went back anymore. They stayed there with their families, or they met someone from the area, you know, like you don't have to stick with your family, or maybe you don't have a family when you're being moved and you meet someone and you create ties there. So I think it's a mixture of both in my project, this idea of some are being moved and some move, follow them.
Okay. So, I mean, to me, reading, it sounds rather forceful to say are moved abroad. Mm-hmm. And I understand that when you do enroll and you go into the army or the Roman Empire, you know, in terms of then, they were acquiring a lot and, you know, they had a lot of power, you know, at that time. So it was, I would like to think, to envision it as, you know, it was like, I want to be in the army. I want to travel the world because I've heard the stories, you know, I want to be a part of it. I want to win something for the country. So when you put there, are moved, I'm thinking, you know, it doesn't really tally up with the way they you know, they took over the world. I mean, it was a big empire.
Yeah.
In that sense. So that's why I'm asking, are moved, isn't that a bit harsh?
Yeah, I could understand that. And maybe, yeah, that's why I said it's a mixture of both, because somehow they had to, even if they didn't want to, but I'm sure some of them wanted to. Sadly, we cannot know. That's the problem. These are just so intangible that you, like, there's no material that you could possibly use to find out. But, you know, in regards to this, I want to emphasize that other works have kind of put an emphasis on how the Romans would look, would regard the non-Roman citizens as maybe, like, you know, inferior. And it was the case with the Batavians, who are perceived as this, there was this image of them almost like a stereotype. There were these beasts that could cross rivers fully mounted on the horse and having the gear and everything, and they somehow tried to fight against that image and be like, okay, we're not just that, you know, like, look at us, we have like great fighting skills, and why are you kind of putting us on the lower tier as compared to the legionary units? Because we also have the legionary units, which are made of Roman citizens, and they got paid more, they were treated better because they were considered the superior ones, let's say. And we kind of see in the Batavians this image and this struggle of, you know, wanting to stay true to themselves, but at the same time being put in the same bucket, you know, with the lower people, you know, the provincials, you know, the ones that are not citizens. And they were trying to fight off that image. So yes, as you said, on one hand, they really wanted to be moved just to show, to prove themselves. For them, it was just a struggle. Okay, like, look at us, we're winning all these fights. They were very famous. If you look, Batavian auxiliaries, they were super famous. The ones that, this is debatable, but more or less, you know, they tried to recruit people from the same area and keep the unit still very much ethnic, as opposed to others. So it was a constant struggle of being moving.
I understand what it is that you're saying, and just based on your example there, I will flip it and say, okay, so if we were in a restaurant. We have the head chef, and I believe there's someone called the sous chef, and then we have the waitresses, and then we have the front of house, and then we have the potters, the ones that clean. So for the restaurant to work, the potters have to wash the pots, because if they don't clean up, that means they're going to be rats, and therefore we won't pass the inspections and the food won't come out because there's no clean pots and pans. So therefore, in terms of order of importance, it's not really the chef, it's the one that's cleaning the place and the one that's washing the pots. So therefore, moving back to, you know, your example, that's why I'm like, our moved abroad is harsh, because those people, in terms of order of importance in society, as you know, the people who do the hardest jobs, usually they're not really put on a higher pedestal. They're usually looked down upon, but they're the ones who keep us safe in society. For example, the bin man.
Mm-hmm.
If there was no one to pick up our rubbish, there'll be, you know, a lot of stuff going on outside.
Yeah.
You know, yeah. If the one who cleans our sewers, there'll be, but yet we, when it comes to value and respect, we don't go, oh, that's a, or the one who picks our onions from the farm. I would never do such a thing, but we need those onions, otherwise our food wouldn't taste nice. So it's like the value. So that's why I'm like, our moved is still quite a harsh thing, because when I'm looking at it in terms of current day, we're still in the same predicament in terms of value. Mm-hmm. Like you said, there were the biggest fighters, there were the ones who actually bringing the name, the thunder, to say, yes, we are the Roman Empire, yet they didn't get anything.
Mm, yeah.
Essentially.
So is it like you're kind of saying this sort of hierarchy, was it necessary? Because that's what I understand from what you're saying, yeah. You know, this was necessary, you know, I'm sorry, you might be a great fighter, you might take us out of a lot of troubles, but we're not going to treat you the same still. You know, that's upsetting. And that's why I'm kind of trying to focus so much on this and shed light on this more, you know, the rather invisible culture, let's say, because so much, you know, the research has focused on the Romans and Romanization, where everything was just homogenized and, you know, no one kept any of their character, and that's wrong. Like, that's not how it worked, you know. So I'm just, you know, I'm there with the Batavians, kind of, you know, I got you, I'm gonna show that you kept some of your stuff, you weren't just erased.
You were the fighting the good fight, maintaining the culture, the ethos, etc. No, I do get you. So in terms of advice then, for somebody who's thinking, right, this sounds amazing, going back in history, if someone wants to do a similar topic, like,
okay,
what advice do you have for them?
I think you need to be very open-minded, because I started this thinking this is very archaeological, this is purely archaeological, and I had some maybe narrow ideas sometimes, because I never looked at this identity as, you know, this kind of fluid thing, and how, you know, it was kept, preserved, and all that sort of transformed. And it was so difficult at the beginning, delving into this social science part. So I think, yeah, for someone who wants to kind of do this, they need to be prepared to look a little bit into everything and put concepts together, and just be ready for a lot of uncertainty. Because in my case, I'm working with material culture, and normally, you know, back then I would have said, okay, this pot looks, I don't know, it looks British.
Mm-hmm.
And it's I found it in Romania. Oh my gosh, definitely some British people were here. No, that's a big assumption, preconception. And I had to work so hard to give up on those and think, wait, but what if someone from Romania went to Britain. They were like, oh, this is a cool pot. I want to have this at home. Came back with that British pot, but turns out there's no British person there. It's just a Romanian who decided this looks great. I want it. So it's a lot of these things, that these assumptions that you have to kind of push them apart and try to think, okay, what are the options here? It's just so uncertain working with material culture sometimes.
No, that's quite interesting. So in terms of the next steps then, what advice would you give somebody when it comes to getting a scholarship or funding?
I think you need to have a very well-defined idea. It's not necessarily very niche all the time. You know, it still has some relevance a little bit, because I'm speaking from my experience. I relate with my research a lot as myself, having left my own culture and ending up somewhere else. And I think a lot of other people could relate to this, and it's great to see, you know, someone going to the roots of that. And I think you need to be aware how your research impacts and has that sort of effect on other people. And once you kind of understand that, then just put the basics of it, have a really strong core, because otherwise it's not gonna stand. I tried with mine several times. I must have written my my proposal so many times, because at the beginning it was, as I said, a bit too narrow. I just started simply with, okay, you know, these Batavians, they're in Romania, I want to research that. Okay, and you know, and then, you know, it finally ended up being as this wider comparison between different areas and their material. So I would say just take the time to make sure that the topic is relevant enough, it's complex enough, and you have the necessary material for that. That was a scare for me, because I was always scared, what if the material doesn't speak at all? You know, it's tricky. So you need to make sure your material, your data speaks to you. And yeah, nonetheless, make it come through your proposal. That's crucial.
Excellent. So finally, what made you want to come on PhD Hard Talk and have a conversation with me?
So I received that message, right? First, I needed to see, okay, what is this about? So I looked, and then I saw these interviews. Oh, that's really interesting. You know, I like how, you know, you include people from all over the place. And then I started looking more into it. And then I saw, yes, there are like people from all different parts of the world and with all sort of topics. And, you know, I was like listening to them, and I thought, I knew nothing about this, you know, and it was just me, I don't know, in my bed before sleep, scrolling on Instagram. And I thought, okay, I can find out so much, you know, and not feel like I'm wasting time while being on Instagram. And yeah. I was like, you know, if I can also do this and the other person can feel the same thing, they look at it and they think, oh, okay, this is really interesting. I didn't know, you know, and they lock their phone thinking, I found out something new today, then yeah, why not? I was going to be part of this kind of chain learning sort of thing.
Oh, wow. Hey, that's quite interesting, the way you've put it. And thank you very much for even going on IG and looking at some of the interviews and getting the message in terms of what I'm trying to do, essentially, in the sense of educating the wider community. So thank you very much for that. And then I would like to say thank you so much for your time, Cristina, today. It's been wonderful. And I wish you all the best in terms of the next steps.
Thank you so much for having me. It was also great to be here. And honestly, I love the questions. They were so challenging. I'm just going to go back to my research and tweak some things here and there. So yeah, I think this communication is very good for the wider community and for the person themselves, you know, the one being interviewed. So thank you so much for this and your insights as well. It was great.
You're welcome, and thank you.
Thanks.